Character is what you are in the dark. What are you in the dark? That's your character. A loveless life is a living death. Life without love is a living death. Therefore, manners carry the world for the moment, but character for all the time. Manners carry the world for a moment, but character carries the world at all time. Our topic this morning is the purpose of the anointing. The purpose of the anointing. The purpose of the anointing. Why did God give mankind anointing? Why do you need anointing? Are there people in the Bible that God bestowed anointing upon their life for their secular work? Not just for the ministry, but for the secular work. You need anointing in your secular job for you to succeed. You need the endowment of God's supernatural ability for you to be able to do or to accomplish your desires. Turn your Bible a moment in the book of Isaiah chapter 11. I'm going to read from verse 1 through 5. Isaiah chapter 11, verses 1 through 5. There shall come forth a rod from the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. His delight is in the fear of the Lord, and he shall not judge by the sight of his eyes, nor decide by the hearing of his ears, but with the righteousness he shall judge the poor, and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. He shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall slay the wicked. Righteousness shall be the belt of his loins, and the faithfulness the belt of his waist. Now the question is, this particular portion of the scripture is talking about who? Before we touch the anointing. This particular portion of the scripture talks about Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, who came from the root of Jesse. The Bible told us about Jesus Christ, the Messiah. The anointing that was upon his life, there was sevenfold anointing upon Jesus Christ, as we saw in the book of Isaiah 11. Sevenfold anointing that was bestowed upon Jesus Christ in order to carry out the mission that God Almighty, his Father, has sent him into the world. You and I also need to receive anointing to be able to fulfill the plans and purposes of God in regards to anywhere we serve in our life, be it in the ministry or in the secular world. So what do we see that the Bible told us? The Spirit of the Lord. Second, they talk about the Spirit of wisdom. Spirit of wisdom. You need wisdom in order to accomplish whatever that you have desired in your life. He talked about, again, the understanding, spirit of understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge, and of the fear of the Lord. And the Bible begins to describe the very nature of Christ in relationship to the people he's going to meet, how he's going to judge, righteous judgment. That he's not going to judge by what he sees. The problem of mankind today, why we cannot operate in anointing, is because we go by what we see. But the Bible said in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7, that we must not go by sight, but by faith. Hebrews 11, 6. And again, it says, he will not go by what he hears. Many of us are influenced because of what we hear. And 90% of what we hear many times are not of God. This is nothing but rumors. And we begin to condemn people. So as we look into this portion of the scripture, These verses provide an accurate description of the Messiah, Jesus. He was to be a descendant of King David. He was to be filled with the power of the Holy Ghost. As the Bible said in the book of Matthew chapter 3 verse 16. How Holy Ghost descended upon Jesus Christ in the form of dove. He will be a merciful but true judge to the world, to mankind. Now the question is the work of the Holy Ghost upon Jesus. How did Holy Ghost get involved with the work of Jesus before we talk about the anointing? Remember, Holy Ghost is the person who distributes the anointing upon each life. So how did he operate with Jesus? The Bible told us in the book of Luke chapter 4 verse 1 that Jesus was led by the Spirit. He was always Holy Ghost led, not flesh led. Our problem in our families is that we are fleshly led. We begin to fight with our spouse in pretenses that we are in the Spirit. Bible says Jesus was led in the Spirit. In the book of Luke, again, chapter 4, verse 14 through 15 and verse 18, the Bible told us the Holy Ghost inspired the teachings of our Lord Jesus Christ. And that is what I always ask, Lord, help me that every teaching and preaching that come through this mouth of clay must be inspired by you, O Lord, by the power of the Holy Ghost. So that anybody who hears it, we know that this is from the throne room of God and not man made. Thirdly, Jesus also walked with the Holy Ghost, and Holy Ghost helped him to perform miracles. The Bible told us in the book of Luke chapter 4 verse 18, he moved in the power of signs and wonders. He moved in power of miracles. God wants you to move in the power of miracles, if you know it. Anywhere you are, be it in your workplace, you're supposed to be a person who operates in signs and wonders. That is why the Bible declared in the book of Isaiah chapter 8 verse 18, look at me and the children of my people, for we are for signs and wonders in the land of Israel. You're supposed to move in signs and wonders because your Savior moved in signs and wonders. In the book of Hebrews, chapter 9, verse 14, the Bible told us how the Holy Ghost was involved with Jesus, who gave himself for you and for me. Because Holy Ghost was with him, and he had that grace to give his life on the cross of Calvary for our salvation. In the book of Romans, chapter 1, verse 4, the Bible declared and said, it was also through the Holy Ghost involvement that Jesus also had his resurrection and also exaltation. Resurrection and exaltation. Now this morning you may ask me, Pastor, what is anointing? What is anointing? Anointing is a supernatural ability endowed in a believer to do extraordinary things for the glory of God. Supernatural. Anointing is an enabling grace to operate in the realm of the Spirit. Thirdly, anointing is the essence, the presence and power of the Holy Spirit that manifests in and around a believer for effective ministry. That's what anointing is. Anointing is the power of God demonstrated in our lives for the work of the ministry. That's what anointing is. Anointing is needed in every aspect of your life. Anointing is the needed lubricant that oils the engine of your calling. Engine of your calling in your ministry. It is the oil that will help you to do your work perfectly than anyone else in your office. The anointing. And that's why when you do things, your boss can say, this is different. You are different from the other person because you are operating in supernatural. You are not depending on the natural because you have degree, because you have certificate, because you have experience. No, but you are depending on the supernatural Because God let his anointing to be upon you for you to begin to do things that you could not do with your natural ability. Anointing of the Holy Ghost ensures excellence and optimal performance. Anointing brings about excellence and optimal performance. That whatever you do, you see a breakthrough, you see things changing, people begin to wonder, how does he do this? Because you carry the anointing of God. No one can truly succeed in the ministry without the anointing of the Holy Spirit. If you are getting problem in your workplace, maybe your bosses are always picking on you. You need to ask God for anointing. Because you'll be operating in flesh. Operating based on your skill and your talent. That's your problem. Because you thought that, well, I know it. I know how to do it. I know. I got degree. It is not the degree that will do that work. Degree is only a piece of paper where your name is written. But we are talking about operating through the Spirit of God, who searches all things and knows all things. When you get confused in your work, if you're a sensitive person in the spirit, that's when you need to move back and say, Lord, forgive me, I need help. Supernaturally open my eyes and let me know what I'm supposed to do. Because, Lord, when I pray and receive, I will glorify your name. But when an unbeliever is blessed, they say they are lucky. But I, as your child, I will glorify your name. It is your enabling grace that helped me to perform well. That's anointing. Have you ever asked God for anointing? The Bible says that you strive because you are in flesh. Because no spirit. Because where the Spirit of God is, there is liberty. And you'll be able to operate and do things accordingly without getting easily stressed up. Many times I hear Christians say, I'm stressed up. I cannot take it. Then I know that this one is in flesh. Even though you speak in tongues, you're easily stressed up. Because when the Holy Ghost is upon you, Holy Ghost is that very person who gives you the anointing. Anointing is that lubricant that oils the engine of your life to do better. That's what it is. When you put oil in a rusted nut or bolt, what happens? The oil will lose its rusted substance. Then you are able to tighten the knot or to lose the knot. Are you getting what I'm saying? The same thing the Holy Ghost does. When your life is rusted, you need the lubricant of the Holy Ghost to be freed. So in your workplace, if you have been encountering problems, wherever you go, you create problem or they create problem for you. Listen, you are not an Ishmaelite. You are Israelite. The Bible told us in the book of Genesis concerning Ishmaelite. That Ishmael, his hand will be against everybody and everybody's hands will be against him. Church, you are not Ishmaelite. You are Israelite. You are prince unto God. Therefore, you need to move in that power that rose Jesus from the dead. And shine as light in the midst of darkness. That's anointing we're talking about. Let's continue. Jesus instructed his disciples to wait for the power and the presence of the Holy Ghost before they begin to do anything they have to do. Church, when you enter into your workplace, believers, what do you do in the morning? From the work, from your car, you begin to calculate what you need to do. You totally forget about God. And the devil is waiting for you at the door. And he too power. They say, I don't know why they're picking on me. I cannot take it. I think I have to resign. I have to quit. And tomorrow when you quit, you don't get a job. You say, I've been praying no job. Because you were out of the will of God. You were not within the will of God. Jesus knew it. That's why he told his disciples in the book of Acts chapter 1 verse 8. Jesus said, when the Holy Ghost is come upon you, you shall receive power. Acts chapter 1 verse 8. When the Holy Ghost come upon you, you shall receive power. Then you become witnesses. You are able to reach out to the unreached, touch the untouched, love the unloved, and teach the untaught. Because of the Holy Ghost. Prior to that, in the book of Luke chapter 24 verse 49, Jesus told the disciples, tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until you are endued with power. Tarry in the city of Jerusalem. Because Jesus knew what it is to operate in anointing. Say, tarry ye. You cannot write a book unless you carry anointing. When you write a book just to impress, people read it like a story. When you preach without anointing, people just get bored. But when anointing of God is upon that, something begins to happen. Questions begin to rise within the heart of the people. The anointing of God. Beloved, we need anointing of God to succeed in all our endeavors. We need anointing to excel in life. We need anointing to make a difference in your workplace, in your relationship with people. You need anointing. You'll not be easily inflated because people praise you. And you'll not be easily irritated because people are picking on you. Because anointing will always oil those rusted areas of your life. The rough edges will be smoothed up. That's what it, and when you talk, the words that come out of your mouth will not be words of anger. Bible said, let your word minister grace to the hearer. You will not be putting papaya faces everywhere you go. Because the joy of the Lord will be your strength. You will not be picking on people. Rather, you will see them as the Lord sees them. You always be a source of help for people, wherever you are. Now you may ask a question. Can we see those the Lord anointed in the Bible, beside Moses, beside Joshua, beside the New Testament apostles, are there ordinary people God anointed in the Bible? The answer is yes. And that's where we are going now. So that you know that you, as a child of God, you need the anointing of God in your office to perform your job. You need anointing of God to do your business. You need anointing of God to do whatever you are called to do in life. Turn your Bible a moment. In the book of Exodus. Book of Exodus chapter 35. Exodus 35. Verses 30 through 35. And we are going to read also verse 1 in chapter 36. Exodus 35, verse 30 through 35, and also 36, verse 1. And Moses said to children of Israel, see, the Lord has called by name Bezalel, the son of Ur, the son of Hur, of the tribe of Judah, and he has filled him with the Spirit of God in wisdom and understanding, in knowledge, and all manner of workmanship. Let's stop the moment. Prior to this, we read the book of Isaiah 11 concerning the anointing, sevenfold anointing that was upon Jesus Christ. You see the anointing here now? Upon a common man. A common man. Moses told the people of Israel, see, God had called Bezalel, the son of Ur, a man of Judah, and filled him with the Spirit of the Lord, Spirit of wisdom, Spirit of understanding. You need the same thing for you to be able to succeed in life. Let's continue. Look at verse 31. And he has filled him with the Spirit of God in wisdom, in understanding, in knowledge, and all manner of workmanship to design artistic works, to work in gold and silver and bronze, in cutting jewels for setting, in carving wood, and to work in all manner of artistic workmanship. And he has put in his heart the ability to teach to him and Aholiab, the son of Ahisamak, of the tribe of Dan. He has filled them with skill to do all manner of work of the engraver and a designer and a tapestry maker in blue, purple, and scarlet thread and fine linen and of the weaver, those who do every work and those who design artistic works and be zealous and Aholiab and every gifted artisan in whom the Lord has put wisdom and understanding to know how to do all manner of work for the service of the sanctuary shall do according to all that the Lord has commanded. The Lord blessed these two men with special endowment of anointing to do his work. Same thing the Lord has blessed you with his anointing, but it remains for you to activate it. You cannot activate your so-called anointing without a strong prayer life. That's the key. Strong prayer life to activate that anointing upon your life. The anointing upon your life is for service. It's not for you to sit down and fold your legs and rub your legs. It's for service. Therefore, when Moses has spoken this, what happened? These men begin to do all that they were instructed to do. Remember, they had ability to invent, plan, and make curious works in gold, silver, and brass. When you have anointing of God, you have that invention ability, planning ability. You have that within you to see how to move forward. That's why you see some leaders don't know what to do. Even the department you gave them to lead, they suddenly will run out of ideas, waiting to be carried and spoon-fed. Because they run out of ideas. Because they never consulted the God of knowledge, the God of understanding, and the God of wisdom in order to move forward. I remembered about 7 years back, a man, we used to share the same hotel. And this man has a smaller church of about maybe 40 people. He met me once in the toilet. He said, "Hey, Pastor, how are you?" I said, "Fine, thank you." "Wow, Pastor, can I ask you one question?" I said, "Please go ahead." He told me, "Pastor, since you've been here, all this while with me, with our church, I mean, it seems that you have been preaching every Sunday and every Wednesday. How do you get the message?" "I preach only once in 2 months and I struggle." I look at him, what do I answer him? How can I talk to a pastor? So I just smile. The difference is the time you spend with God and anointing you carry. If you want to increase the anointing of God upon your life, well, you have to increase your regular appearance to the Lord. The more you come to the Lord, the more he lay hands. There's something I saw in the spirit, and that's why I don't want to let go. Whenever anyone goes to God in prayer, after finishing prayer, the moment you want to go, he will stretch out his hand. Anytime you come, you cannot live without God laying hand on you. So if you come once a year, you get once a year anointing. If you come once in 7 years, well, you get once in 7 years anointing. Because that's what you want. That's why God said, "Come unto me, come. So you see, they had this wisdom, and it was given to them, and also they had the ability to cut jewels, stones, in verse 33 of that very Exodus 35. Ability to set stones, ability to carve wood, to teach in the trades, to engrave metals and stones, verse 35, to also embroider beautiful designs in clothing, to weave cloth of plain and intricate designs. They are able to do that because of the anointing of God. Many of us have been anointed, but we are not able to activate that. If you have a website, you have to activate it, or it will be like a dead place. You have to activate it. You must do it. If you go and dig a borehole, after digging that borehole and put all the things that require pipe, you need to activate it. for it to be bringing out water. You have to activate it. You've been blessed because you are born again. You are feeling the Holy Ghost and you speak in tongues, praise the Lord. But you need to activate the anointing of God upon your life. Because not just speaking in tongues, God did not call you and said, well, apostles, go to the upper room and you shall receive tongue talking. Say, go and receive power. Power. Now you may ask a question. How about Jesus Christ? In the book of Isaiah, chapter 61, verse 1 through 3, we can see the anointing that was upon Jesus Christ and how he used them, the anointing. The Bible told us in the book of Isaiah, 61, verse 1 through 3, that anointing that was upon Jesus Christ was to preach good tidings to the meek, to bind up the brokenhearted. If your heart had been broken, well, Jesus came that he might bind it up. To proclaim liberty to the captives. Maybe you feel that you're under control. Jesus has come to set you free. Just as the prophecy said this morning, shake up the dust, shake up the shackles, come out from your captivity and look unto God. The anointing upon Jesus Christ was to open the prisons to them that are bound. That's anointing. He wants to bring you out from your prison yard. Not only that, to proclaim the day of vengeance of God, to let you know there will be a day when God had to bring judgment. And not only that, also to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord, that anointed upon the Lord Jesus Christ, to comfort those who are sorrowful. Maybe you've been hurt and wounded, disappointed. That's why Jesus carried anointing, to comfort you, because you are under mourning. To appoint unto them that mourn in Zion and give beauty for ashes. Maybe your life has become life of hopelessness. That's why Jesus came. Life in Christ is beautiful. But life without Christ is in crisis. Life in Christ is endless hope. Life without Christ is a hopeless end. You must know it. So you have to think about that. Jesus came to give oil of joy. For you to receive oil of joy. Oil of joy. Those areas that you have been bruised. Those areas that you have been hurting. Those areas that you have blue blacks in your spirit. Christ come to put oil to heal you. Christ come to put a smile on your face. Christ come to wipe away your tears. He had come to give you a garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. That your mouth be filled with praise. That's anointing he carried. That's anointing of God upon Jesus Christ. He came to give you garment of praise instead of garment of heaviness. You may ask another question. The purpose of anointing upon your life, upon my life. We have seen the anointing upon Jesus Christ. We know what anointing is. But why do you need anointing? That's a question. Which you need to know why you need anointing in your life. Because the Bible declared in the book of Isaiah chapter 10 verse 27. That anointing breaks the yoke. There are yokes upon your life. Yokes of curses which you inherited from your family. Maybe your father is a tyrant. So you marry, you want to be another tyrant in the house. Maybe your mother is chatterbox. You come also begin super one. There's something that needs to be cut out of your life so that you be freed completely. Have you ever pulled back and asked yourself this question? Young man, why am I quarreling with my wife? Is it the same thing my father was doing with my mother? We don't ask that question. We just become oblivious to reality in our own home. Have you ever asked yourself, why are you behaving the way you behave? Madam of the house, Have you ever asked yourself this question? Why are you is this the way my mother was behaving and my father was not happy? Both of you need to ask questions. The Bible said in the book of Jeremiah, ask where you are going. You need to ask questions. You can sit back and just reflect. You grew up in your family. You know the relationship between your father and your mother. Are you seeing some symptom of your father in you now that cause problem in your family? You girl, madam, you know how your mother and your father are related to each other. Have you ever asked a question? Are you seeing some symptom of that kind of life in your family now? If that is the case, you need to pull back and say, hey, we need anointing to break this yoke. But the problem is nobody wants to ask, nobody wants to care, nobody wants to know. It's like, I can do what I want to do. And that's why you're having problems, God's people. Now, what's the purpose of anointing? The anointing upon our life is to bring good news to those who are afflicted, as we saw in the book of Luke chapter 4 verse 18. For us to be not only bringing good news, but to be a written epistle, as Apostle Paul said, to the church of Corinthians. You are our written epistle. I always ask myself this question. What will people feel if they were to see me misbehaving? There are many people who admire your life because they never known you really. Until they don't know who you really are, say, wow, I don't want to get involved. We are supposed to be light in the midst of darkness. Not only preaching, but we need to be open Bible that people read. In every aspect of our life. And let it be that any accusation thrown on you is a false one. Not because you have done that thing. Secondly, we are to produce results in everything that we are doing. That's the purpose of anointing. Produce results. Result producing believer in every aspect. Be it in your workplace, be it in your family, be it in the ministry, be it in the church. The book of Psalms chapter 92 verse 10. Produce results. When that thing comes in you to make you angry, for you to go and bounce on your spouse, you say, no. How about when you feel so angry, instead of you bouncing on your spouse like a lion, you cuddle her? Why not surprise her? And then she said, why? I love you. You don't pretend. Why not? Thirdly, purpose of anointing. To maintain a holy and pleasing life to God. That's why you get the anointing. To maintain a holy and a pleasing life. When Apostle Paul was writing to the church of Romans, in the book of Romans chapter 2 verse 1, he said to present our body a living sacrifice unto the Lord. A pleasing life. When you live life full of anointing of God, you will never suspect people. You will never suspect anybody. As I always say, let it be that people are innocent unless proven guilty. Not that people are guilty unless proven innocent. It must not be. People must be innocent. When anointing of God is upon you, you will never suspect people. Because you have a holy thought. Just as we receive in the prophecy, your words holy, your actions holy, your relationship holy, your discussion, your conduct holy. The anointing, the purpose of anointing upon Allah is to equip us spiritually, physically, and morally in order to accomplish God's will. To equip us physically. Do you know something? Listen, many people who are involved in the ministry, they will only pray when they are going to serve. If they are going to serve tomorrow or Wednesday, on Tuesday they'll go and pray. So that's only when they're supposed to be holy. After that, anything goes. Are you one of them? When you're supposed to preach, then you go and fast and pray. But if you're not preaching, never mind. That's hypocritical. He's supposed to be ready at all times. When God spoke through prophet Amos in the book of Amos, chapter 4, verse 12, he said, O house of Jacob, because I'm going to do this, be ready to meet your God. Are you ready? Are you ready? If I am not ready, I will be scared even to drive a car in case I get an accident. Therefore, I have to be ready at all times. I got to be ready in case somebody come to me and say, Pastor, pray for me. Can you imagine if I'm not ready? You come and pray for you. I say, oh, you know what? you come to me on Wednesday. Because on Wednesday I'm fasting. How will you feel? Because you're not ready. You're equipped by the anointing. Another purpose for anointing upon your life is to demonstrate God's power through signs and wonders. Through signs and wonders. Signs and wonders is not only for the fivefold ministers. When we talk about fivefold ministers, as the Bible told us in the book of Ephesians, chapter 4, we're talking about the apostles, the prophets, the pastors, the teachers, and the evangelists. But mind you that the signs and wonders is not only for the fivefold ministers. It is for every believer because the Bible says so. The Bible declared in the book of Luke chapter 10 verse 19. What did it say? Behold, I give you authority. It didn't say only to believers. Only to pastors. I give you authority to trample upon serpents and scorpions and over all the powers of the enemy. And nothing will touch you. In the book of Matthew chapter 18 verse 18 it says, Behold, what you bind on earth is bound in heaven. What you lose on earth is loose in heaven. God has given you the keys. Bind that anger. When you carry the anointing of God, you will not always be defensive. Fight. That's what we call kiasu. I must win. I must win. You cannot win. I must win. Kiasu attitude. Talk this one. Talk. Just who will outdo the other one? Husband and wife. They will never stop. Until children say, enough. See, they will never stop. Anointing of God is upon you for you to defeat devil and his host. To bring about growth and increase in the work of the Lord. That's why some people don't like responsibility. Because when you talk about increase, talk about evangelism, they say, it's all about numbers. But we are commanded to go and reach out to the unreached, touch the untouched, and love the unloved. That's the command Jesus gave to us. It's not all about numbers. It's all about winning souls and expanding the kingdom of God. The question is, since you become a believer, how many people have you won to the Lord? If you talk about numbers. Anointing of God is upon our lives for us to be able to be effective in the operation of the gift of the Holy Spirit. It's the anointing of God that will enable you to be effective in operating in a nine gift of the Holy Ghost and also in a nine fruit of the Spirit. Anointing of God. Anointing of God enables us also to be victorious in all affairs of life. To bring about enduring results in the ministry. The result will be enduring. It will not just be for a moment. It will be lasting results. That's what it will be. In all that you do, ask God for the anointing to break the yoke in your life. Yoke of anger. Yoke of fault-finding. Yoke of talking too much. A great talker is a great liar. Yoke of also envy and jealousy. Yoke of condemnation of others. Yoke of forefinding. Yoke of judgmental attitude. You may ask me, how do we get this anointing of the Spirit? The Bible told us in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 2 verse 11 that the Holy Ghost is the one who gives the anointing and power. He distributes it to individuals. Ask Holy Spirit to anoint. You need it in your life. We must have the person of the Holy Spirit in our lives. We must have his presence and his power too. The continuous presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives produces power for living. The more the Holy Ghost presence is upon you, you are able to overcome your shortcomings. I know many people have taken their resolution, but they are falling back to where they are coming from. Because you did not ask for Holy Ghost presence to lead you to become overcomers. What do you gain in your so-called anger? What do you gain in your controlling spirit to control others? What do you gain? What do you gain in remembering the wrong people had done to you in the past? That's all you remember. You don't remember good things, only the bad things. I remember 2 years back you did like this. I remember 10 years back you did like this. I remember 100 years back you did like this. Whatever is done 100 years back, you remember. But whatever good is done to you today, you don't remember. Because we choose to remember what we want to remember. And choose not to remember what we don't want to remember. Because it will be for the benefit of the other person. You may ask a question. What will happen when there is absence of the Holy Ghost in our lives? Church, if you are a person, a man or woman or a boy or girl who moves in anointing, you will know when somebody speaks in flesh. You know when they act based on flesh. You will know. Because you can judge between the spirit and the non-spirit. When there is absence of the Holy Ghost, there will be spiritual dryness. Spiritually dried. Every time the word of God will mean nothing to you. Every word of God will be the same. I think the same thing. Because you're spiritually dried. I think the same different topic, but the same content. Because you are spiritually dried. You are no more drawing from the pool of God anymore. It becomes the same to you. You are spiritually dried. Secondly, there will be lack of growth, success, and victory in your life. You will never experience success. You never experience victory. You never experience spiritual growth. When was the last time when you had experience with God through dreams or divine visitation? This year is year of divine visitation, year of supernatural. When was the last time you ever experienced supernatural presence of God? Either hear his voice or see his glorious presence. Or sense in your spirit what he is telling you or about to do for you. When there's lack of spirit, you'll be lacking. Spiritual growth, you will not have. Success, victory, total out. Next, when there's absence of the Holy Ghost, there'll be coldness in worship. Your worship will become a formal worship. There'll be coldness. You'll be using your so-called energy, skill, and talents, yet nothing moves because there's no spirit in it. There'll be coldness. You'll become a performer, not a worship leader. You become a performer. You are performing to entertain people, not to edify them. Your worship will entertain people, but not edifying them. You'll be longing for compliments. Yes. Compliments. That's what we're longing for. Next. When there's absence of the Holy Ghost, you'll be spiritually tired. Spiritual tiredness will take place. Discouragement, confusion, and you will always be thinking about throwing in the towel. You'll be thinking about resigning. You're thinking about quitting. Because there's no spirit. God cannot call you into the ministry, put you in the ministry and tell you to leave. Unless there is presence of sin. Otherwise, it will not. Even if there's presence of sin, God can use you to rectify those things. Because he said, if I can find 10 people. If I can find in Sodom and Gomorrah. If I can find. That's how merciful our God is. In the absence of the Holy Ghost, there will be lack of guidance and spiritual direction. Lack of guidance and spiritual direction. People will not have direction. You won't know where you're going. You won't know what you're doing. That's what happened to many leaders. They're spiritually blind because lack of spirit. They don't know either to go right or left or forward or back. They don't know. They become spiritually blind. There'll be worldliness of life. Their life will be full of worldliness, behaving like the people of the world. Anything they do will be all in tune with the world. They want to be like others. There'll be flesh manifestation and deception. They will always be depending on how God dealt with them some years back. They become like clouds without rain. Clouds without rain. That's what they'll be like. The only thing, I remember 3 years back when God did this. So what about now? No more. No more. Church, don't tell me how God spoke to you yesterday. Does God speak to you today? The moment you stop hearing from heavenly headquarters, your ministry is over. But how can you hear him when you never made time to seek the Lord? You're only busy in eating, fellowshipping with, talking with people. Do you have time for the Lord? How much time do you spend with your spouse praying or seeking God? Or even alone seeking God? But you can come and you must do like this, must do like that. That's why sometimes I look at some leader when they talk, I know they're talking in flesh. They only talk based on skill and talent, not talking based on spirit-led. And be careful also that you are not deceived by religious words and thinking the spirit. Some people can talk religiously. You think it's spirit, it's not. You must learn to differentiate between religious talk and spirit-led. When there's absence of the Holy Ghost, there'll be pretenses and assumption. Pretenses and assumption. People will pretend and they will assume. Have you ever seen some people, they tell you, oh, when I come in there, I feel something. He said, what do you feel? Oh, I saw one black thing under the car there, under the chair there. He said, what black thing? I think it got hung. Rubbish. All these are assumption. Then when you query more, question more, inquire more, they say, oh, maybe I'm wrong. You see. All in flesh. Assumptions. Hypothesis. They operate in what I call emotional hypothesis. Last and not the least, strife and contention. When there is no spirit, there will be strife and contention. Finding fault. Oh, because you did like this, that's why I did like that. Oh, because you did like this, that's why I did like this. You think what? What do you do? Huh? I can. They fight. Beloved God's people, success is only possible through anointing of the Holy Ghost. Why you are not succeeding is because you lack the anointing. The key is anointing. God wants to flow through you today. He wants to touch you and transform the course of your life. He wants to change your failure into success. He wants to change your defeat into victory. He wants to change your mediocrity into abundance. That's the will of God. Only because anointing. Plunge into the river of God. Plunge into the river of God's anointing and be on fire for his glory. Anointing is all we need. The wise man who wrote the book of Proverbs declared in the book of Proverbs chapter 4 verse 7, he says, all you need, that the principal thing is wisdom. You need anointing of wisdom. It's because of the anointing of wisdom that Joseph was able to secure the economy of Egypt from collapsing. Because of the anointing of wisdom upon Daniel, he was able to take care of the Babylon kingdom where he was governor. Because of anointing of wisdom. Therefore, Moses knew it, that Joshua needed anointing. He needed the anointing in order to lead the people. The Bible told us in the book of Deuteronomy chapter 34, verse 9, that Joshua, the son of Nun, was full of Holy Ghost, full of wisdom, because Moses laid hand on him. And that's why we lay hand upon our leaders every January. Receive anointing of God. Receive the wisdom to do things. Wisdom to do something concerning your family. Wisdom to do something concerning your work. Wisdom on how to relate to people. Don't always want to have your way. You must also learn that other person also wants his way to be open. Be considerate. Wisdom. Wisdom. When you talk, talk respectfully. A person who carries anointing is not a braggart. A person who carries anointing is not pride, proud. He's not arrogant. Because anointing keeps you humble. Humility is not and will never be a sign of weakness. But because of Christ. Bible said, led Jesus to the slaughter, he opened not his mouth. A man full of anointing. He can call on fire, but he chooses not to. He wants the will of God to be fulfilled. God's people. God wants you to receive. Your Father in heaven wants you to receive anointing. For you to do what he has called you to do. In your workplace, you make a difference in your workplace because of the anointing of God. What about from tomorrow? When you go to work, the way you behave, they say, hey, what happened to this guy? What happened to this lady? Then from there, they begin to see that there are changes in your life because you have a handshake with the Holy Ghost. Because you had a handshake with the Holy Ghost. Because the Holy Ghost has rubbed something into your life. Because the power of God has been rubbed in, you are no more what you used to be, now you are a different person. This is God's word. This is the purpose of anointing for this year. God wants you to move in anointing. Go to your offices, go to your workplaces, and begin to operate in anointing. Go back home and ask God, touch me, Lord. I need the anointing to make a difference. When you hear the voice of God, do not harden your heart.